to the Nerdiverse. Go ahead, sit and listen to the masters, the old heads, talk about what you love the most. Video games, comics, movies, and everything you need to maintain. Yo, we got the knowledge that's straight out the ether. Gonna need a drink and have to take a seat to expand your mind and listen to the speaker. Mike and the squad's gonna give you what you need. Please send in a question, come and get some answers, learn a couple lessons from the masters with the special guests. We got the Green Lanterns glowing on our chest. Yes, please sit back and relax, cause we gonna hit you with them stone cold facts. And allow me to be the very first to welcome you to the Masters of the Nerdiverse. Welcome to the Masters of the Nerdiverse podcast. This is the Mean Gene Fighting Machine, Mike G. You can find this squared circle of a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, SoundCloud, YouTube, my house, your house, we're in the house. What's going on, Winter Trash Month Thizzard?
It's doing great, brother. I'm coming at you live in the Trash Mountain. This is Trash Month the Third. Trash Month, I, Trash Month, I! And I'm coming at you live at SummerSlam.
I thought it was SummerSlort.
SummerSlort. I challenge anyone of these pitzel-headed geeks. I'm going old school with that one.
Yeah, I'm liking it.
Spend 5 minutes with me in the ring. If I get to spend 30 seconds with them in the closet. Folks, I'm doing great.
You're in the closet?
No, isn't that a game like 30 seconds in heaven?
Yeah. Did you ever do that as a kid?
No, I was homeschooled.
You never. So just. You don't have to be homeschooled to be like 5 seconds in heaven, though, you know?
No. Because normally you have to have a partner.
Oh, right. Yeah. Makes sense. And I guess your Stretch Armstrong wouldn't count, right? You know?
No. Dang. Maybe if you like leave it out in the sun to warm up a bit.
What is that tech I never learned about?
I don't know.
Does it make the flesh malleable, dog? Sun-baked Stretch Armstrong. Okay, let's go with that. I like it. That's new tech right there. Oh, if you're listening to this podcast and you know about the sun,
I got Mark Cuban to invest $5 billion on that.
Nice. That's what we needed. That was the turnover we needed, man. I would just sex toy Stretch Armstrong, Doug. This is what took it to the next level. Took our podcast to the next strata of entertainment. We're here in Hoboken, New Jersey. Where's my Hoboken, New Jersey fans at?
Hoboken is a place to be.
That was a theme song. That was a theme song. It's only for Hoboken fans. No one else can enjoy that.
I didn't like that.
Hmm?
I didn't like that noise.
What noise? What noise? Oh, it's just because it takes a special skill, Doug. You know, yeah, it's my mutant. It's my mutant power, Doug. That's what I can do.
Reminds me of Lawrence Welk. You know about Lawrence Welk?
No, educate me on Lawrence Welk, Doug.
So back in the olden days of television, like right when they started getting color, there would be this a band leader named Lawrence Welk, and he would be like the, if you thought American Bandstand was too edgy, he would be the, hello and welcome to another exciting day where we are singing songs of the holidays. Uh-huh. And here is Johnny and Jamie singing To the Bell Tolls. And then the band starts playing, To the Bell Tolls. And then he goes, that's a lovely song. Thank you very much.
At first I would thought, then, yeah.
Yeah, and then they're like, now we're going to have some polka music from the Swiss Alps.
For a split second, I thought you meant For Whom the Bell Tolls, like the Metallica song.
Oh, no.
Can you imagine that?
The only song that I know of that they got away with that was edgy was, and now we're going to do a gospel number, One Toke Over the Line.
Wow. That's edgy, man. So they were like, yeah. So he was like Bob Denver's dad is pretty much what.
Pretty much.
Man.
And yeah, so I watched a few episodes of that when I was little.
That's crazy. Did you ever watch HR Puffin stuff, Doug?
No.
That's HR.
I'm not crazy.
Wait, that, you know, our Fraggle Rock stuff that just, you could tell the writers of it.
I watched the HBO version where they're all on drugs.
Yeah, where they're all on drugs. Doug. Yeah. Shows like Fraggle Rock, and like those are made by stoners. Had to be, man. You can't invent Fraggle Rock in your right frame of mind, dude. It's impossible. Can't do it.
Yep.
It's super impossible, dude. Like, who thinks that up? Like, just, oh, I'm just sitting around. We'll make... Like, Jim Henson must be one of the most baked dudes on Earth in real life, dude. Jim Henson, dude. You can't create like Fozzie Bear and freaking Gonzo just okay. Something's got to be wrong with you, man. You can't stink this stuff up and be like, all right, I'm going to make a Muppet. That I'm going to make Snuffleupagus out of nothing, just out of sheer thought. No, it doesn't. Like, the brain can't work that way, man. This is, I got to know more. There has to be some kind of story to it. You know? It's got to be.
Yeah.
Like, it's got to be some kind of enhancements.
Or there doesn't.
Well, I mean, what are you saying? It's like once every three generations, there's just one human who's born with like abnormal imaginative power, like J.R.R. Tolkien making them late.
Elon Musk.
Is Elon Musk that for our generation, dude?
Yeah, I don't want to say it. No. There's got to be more than three.
I mean, it's like once every three generations, dude. It's like J.R.R. Tolkien. It's like William Shakespeare, but he was doing drugs. We know what Shakespeare was doing drugs. Like every once in a while, there's someone who just explodes imagination until they die, and they just leave the earth with jewels that will last the infinite time. You know, Jim Henson was one of them dudes, man. You just, you know, I'm just gonna invent Kermit the Frog. You know, I hate to say it, but Walt Disney was kind of one of those cats. You know. But I think Walt Disney was more of like a
don't speak ill of Walt.
I'm sorry. Well, he's gone, man. Like, he's not. Walt's not listening. He's off doing something else in the cosmos. I don't know what Walt's doing right now, man. I don't want to speak ill of the mouse, but let's just say, have a strong feeling Walt's not playing dice with Gandhi right now. I just put it like that. He might. Who knows? So winter,
who knows?
Like in the afterlife, would you just want to chill in one spot and just be there, or would you like be okay with like surfing the cosmos as an entity for all eternity, just traveling the universe and checking things out?
I don't know. I'm not a big traveler right now. If I could be in one spot but have like all the books of knowledge around me,
yeah,
I feel like I would be busy.
I don't know. I kind of would want to just surf the universe like the Silver Surfer and just see all the crazy, if there was life anywhere, like just travel all across the universe and see cool things. And, you know, I'd be a spirit. I can't do anything, but at least I could check it out, you know?
Yeah, I just feel like I'd be busy.
Yeah, I mean, if you want infinite knowledge, you know, you could just chill in one spot with all the books and the tablets and all that and just chill, but...
I'd still be on Tinder.
Ghost Winter would be on Tinder deep. Well, pluses. I got the wisdom of infinite universe. Minuses. I can't physically touch you. But if I could talk to you up a storm, though. I'll tell you everything. What you want? What you want to know? Who actually made the best mac and cheese? It wasn't your mama. Ooh, burn. I don't know. Would you date a ghost on Tinder? Okay. I'm not talking about your mother. I'm talking about the royal mother. You know, the universal mother.
Yeah, I'd date a ghost if it worked out.
Like, okay, there's this movie called High Spirits that's an old comedy with Steve Guttenberg,
Peter O'Toole.
Yes, young Liam Neeson.
Never
heard Beverly of it. D'Angelo does. It's one of my favorite movies. In the movie, there's a couple that's unhappy that goes to this giant castle, and it's Peter O'Toole's kind of like Irish castle that he owns, but he's turned it into like a tourist attraction. But the house is legit haunted by two spirits, one male, one female, and they end up swapping mates.
So one of the alive people die, become a ghost, and be with the ghost person. And somehow one of the ghosts gain life back and live with the human. It's really dope. It's old and it's funny. And there's a scene where there's a painting on the wall that's of a giant octopus in water, and it turns into real life, and it's all done with practical effects. And high spirits. That's one of my childhood movies. If you know what I'm talking about, give me props on social media. Let me know. I love that damn movie. Well, we've rattled on long enough. How's your week, man?
Where am I?
I know.
My week has been pretty good, you know. Playing a lot of Rocket League. They're the company that just came out with a program that lays on top of Rocket League and helps you join competitive tournaments. Cool. So I'm curious to try that out sooner rather than later. Yeah. And, you know, just going down the wormhole of history of professional wrestling.
Ooh, I want to talk about that. What have you learned, Winter? What have you learned that's new?
You never want to retire. You just want to die after you're done being a pro wrestler. Holy shit.
Why is it that real, dude? Like, what?
Pretty much, professional wrestling sucks the life out of you.
Yeah, man.
And then you go, well, now I have no knees.
I have zero knees.
And then they go, well, now you can just be a Hall of Famer that appears every now and then.
I mean, it's almost like professional football, where if you, like, there's only so much you can give to the Soul Stone when it comes to performing. Right. But if you really want to become legendary, you have to sacrifice your whole life, Doug. And then be like, you know, the saddest thing I've ever heard is like, what happened with Kurt Angle and how he had to fight back because his body was so wrecked that he was like in constant pain and he became addicted to opiates because that was the only thing that can numb the pain. But then your body starts to get used to that. So you have to go on stronger stuff. I was like, geez, man, that's rough, dude. All just for like comfort. You're not even comfortable because everyone around you is comfortable. People who didn't have to do that, but you, the person who like spent their whole life.
Scary yeah, stuff.
Man. You just got to know when to duck out, man. That's a lot of these, like, football players are starting to get it. They're retiring younger and younger because you can only give your body to that sport or to that profession for only like 5-6 years at max. Right. And if it doesn't spark for you, you just got to cut it out. You know what I mean? And then some wrestlers retire early because of injury. Look at like Paige, the female wrestler from Britain. She got a wicked injury where she's going to be dealing with that for the rest of her life.
Well, hold on. She left because of a video that came out.
She left because of injury. She stayed away because of injury, though. She can't wrestle anymore. She has some like neck injury, but she left because of her and the whole Alberto Del Rio, Austin Creed nonsense.
Yeah, chicken before the egg.
That's cold game. Fair enough. Okay, bad example, apparently. Let's say all wrestlers have kind of crazy stuff going on with them, though. Say, like, remember Taz, the wrestler Taz?
Yeah, FTW.
Yeah, man, and how he literally became like a quadriplegic due to a botched like pile driver or something nuts like that.
Yeah, that's
what I'm saying. But that can happen in football, too. I mean, that's just high-impact activities, you know what I mean? Like, it's kind of crazy. I mean, and it's not like this happens every once in a while in your profession. It happens every single time you step into the ring. Your body's going to take massive amounts of impact and pain.
Yeah. It's a sport that does not... you know, you're grinding away at your body,
yeah,
and there's very little return, to be honest. Now, if you become the head, like a superstar, then you're making 7 figures. But even then, it's sketchy. I also think they're getting a lot better, where a lot of the younger talent does not have the same issues as like Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Where he has no knees anymore, where they're just gone. Yeah.
Yeah. He's just got braces on. But then there's like Yeah. Sometimes it's sad.
I mean, but they have people like...
But other times it's like, you made the deal with Satan.
Like, I wonder, like, how the Undertaker's doing in real life. Like, I wonder if... Does he have a high pain ratio? He seems to be healthy. Like, he doesn't seem like he's all jacked up. He looks a little old and rusty, but...
Oh, you need to... Yeah, I think you should look at pictures of him when he's not at the Undertaker.
Yeah, he probably...
Because there's, like, there's been, like, numerous stories about his knees just being messed up.
Oh, that and, like, sucks.
Shoulders being hurt. Yeah,
but it's like... But that, like you said, that's that Faustian deal that you sign your life away and say to Vince and be like, I will literally do whatever you tell me to do if you give me that push. You know, everybody wants the push. So,
yeah. And I find it crazy. Like, it's so interesting because it's all fake.
Yeah.
But there is a steady group of people who will get upset if you say that it's fake, like in the business. Like, they do not like it when people open up, reveal that it's fake.
Here's the thing, man. To them,
yeah,
it's... I think everybody's at the point where they understand that this is entertainment. You know what I'm saying? No one's in here thinking that there's actual stakes involved. Everything's mapped out and planned out and written out. But I think what people get upset is that when they say it's fake, he's like, well, this injury is not fake. My concussion wasn't fake. You know,
No. I see what you're saying,
you know,
but for the example I was giving, there's like a big issue where two people or like a group of people who are supposed, like, in the storyline have like hate their guts.
Yeah.
On their last night of their contract with WWE, they all came out of the ring, hugged each other and bowed to the audience.
Yeah, I think that was during like the last night for Razor Ramon or something like that. And like,
yeah, like
Triple H and Kevin Nash and all these people who were kayfabe feuding came out to the ring to say goodbye to their buddy. You know what I mean? Who was retiring that night.
Yeah.
And everybody hated it because that's one of the few times in the ring that you got to see a true breaking of kayfabe. You know, so.
Right.
I mean.
And so here's this Jim Cornette dude that I'm watching videos on YouTube going, that ruined the business. They're exposing the business. Meanwhile, 10 minutes later, he's talking about how he's just talking about the backward workings of, well, I'm a writer. I'm a bookie. I'm a booker.
So what are you talking about?
We determine like what's happening on. Yeah. It's a weird psychological thing. Game that pro wrestler people in the business do, or at least when they're talking in front of people. Paul Heyman's an expert at dealing with, well, I'm going to give you a little bit of truth, but then I'm going to like comically go, and no one can defeat Brock Lesnar.
Because everybody knows that he's a monster heel, so he's going to get over. Brock Lesnar has always gotten over.
You know what? You're a monster heel.
I am a monster heel. I squash. Let me get to my week.
But how?
Exactly. Nothing as interesting as falling down a wrestling hole. I did fall down a Predator hole, though. I actually sat and watched The Predator because it was just on. Because I never saw it and I needed to understand, dude.
Yeah, you're not going to say anything about me doing the Predator?
I thought you were snoring because you were bored.
Oh.
So I was just trying to power through it. I didn't know you were making it like... And the thing... Okay, speaking of that...
Well, I wasn't doing that.
That's the Predator noise. You need to go... That's the noise, dude. The thing about this movie that bothered me, speaking of noises, is that... You know the iconic Predator music, right? You know, they got. Yeah, you would think they would have the rights to the music, right? They're making a Predator film, but the thing about it, the music was that it was an octave off. It sounded like Free Enterprise bootleg Predator music in a Predator movie. It was like an octave too high. It was weird. No, I was like, why does this sound off? It doesn't sound right. It was sped up a little bit. It was like maybe like 1.5 faster. And I was like, immediately that set me off for the whole movie. And
go.
Sorry. I love the Predator and Alien and all that. Alan Silvestri beautifulness that music is. But what bothers me about this movie is, you ever seen Independence Day 2, The Resurgence start?
No.
Where Jeff Goldblum is Independence Day 2 because they had...
What's your review of that?
Independence Day 2?
Yeah.
It's hot garbage, dude. It's I wouldn't kick it out of bed for crackers, man. It's garbage. It's the worst, man. It's just... It's one of the... And the Predator does the same thing. Where it's like... It understands why the movie was cool, but doesn't understand why the movie was good. You know what I mean? Where it's like,
right,
okay, we got the Predator. The Predator's going to do cool stuff. We're going to have this ragtag team of mercenaries that are going to go fight the Predator, and we're going to interject human condition. And it's like, on paper, it probably all sounded well, but it was just poorly done. Like, everything from the acting to the actual Predator interactions. They can make the Predators talk. It's just the weakest, man. It's a lot going on with that movie. It was enjoyable, though. It was stupid. I don't mind a good stupid movie every once in a while. Hell, I loved The Meg. And that was literally Jason Statham punching a megalodon in the face and winning.
I'm going to kill this shark.
I'm the transporter. And then I'm going to transport that shark into the other shark. Then I'm going to get him. I hate Jason Statham. I love Jason Statham.
You hate Jason Statham?
No. You got to do the Roger Rabbit. That's the second episode in a row I've mentioned Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I'll stop. Sorry, listeners.
Thank you.
I
was gonna mention. Hey, that's a lot of Roger Rabbit.
I super love Roger Rabbit, man. Yeah. I love everything about it. I was gonna do the Remember Me Eddie line, but that's too high pitched, and I don't want to blow out the mic. I saw on the tip of my tongue. Anyway, I've been playing a lot of Mortal Kombat 11, right? And I discovered that there's an app called PlayStation Remote Play, where you can literally play your game from like your tablet or your phone or whatever. And it boots up your PS4, and it runs and it streams the game from the system to whatever device you're using. So you could be at work and technically play Red Dead Redemption from your phone, but you use like the touchscreen interface. And I was like, well, I'm not going to be pulling off crispy combos with this thing, but what can I do? But so now in Mortal Kombat, you have these towers that you have to run to get like currency and costumes and stuff like that, right? Yeah. And you can set the game up so you can have an automatic AI fighter that fights for you. So what I've been doing is at work, is that I've been just playing Mortal Kombat while I'm at work and just hitting the button and let my character go and earn me all the stuff I'm earning without even playing the game. It's not fun. It's not supposed to be fun. It's just I come home and I have like a bunch of new cosplays. This is not supposed to be fun. It's all grind. And it's I would rather my AI grind it than me having to sit there and fight the same computer 100,000 times. All I want to do is jump online and play human beings, you know. But still having fun with Mortal Kombat. It reminds me a lot of Injustice 2. Of course it would. But it's a little bit more difficult than Injustice 2, actually. Especially the towers. Those towers are beastly, even though they calmed them down a little bit. And other than that, I was kind of tempted to watch that new Jeffrey Dahmer documentary on Netflix.
Not Jeffrey. Yeah, I think so.
Zac Efron is playing him or something like that. Maybe it's not Jeffrey Dahmer. Maybe it's a different Ted Bundy. It's Ted Bundy. Sorry.
Yeah, Ted Bundy.
Yeah, not Jeffrey Dahmer. The Ted Bundy documentary.
The Golden Killer with a Dream.
Wow. Can you imagine living in New York during like the Son of Sam time? And just can't go outside. You can't leave because Son of Sam could just slurp.
Well, I could. I wasn't a woman. I'm not a woman. But
I mean, like being in LA during the Zodiac Killer times, you know what I'm saying? Like,
mm-hmm. You can't. Well, he was in San Francisco, so.
I'm just saying, dude. Like, can you imagine being in that time of being in that area, being affected by that? Where there's, you know.
Yeah.
And you just can't go outside because, you know, So, yeah. You know,
he's gonna catch me outside.
Yeah, he's gonna catch. He's gonna.
How about that?
How about that? Ted Bundy's gonna catch you outside. He's gonna get you. But no, it just makes me think. Like nowadays, I mean, we have so much horror in the news. There's literally like a school shooting today while we're recording, and it's a different atmosphere than, you know, the Boston Strangler. You know what I mean? Like a singular person that's just doing serial killings. You know, that's not the atmosphere anymore. I guess maybe because it's too easy to get caught nowadays. You can't just do it over and over and expect the cops not to catch you.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just think that's kind of weird and fascinating. You know, that the scary things of the country have always shift. You know what I mean? And it's always in the major cities sometimes. But I guess that's only because that the crazy stuff that happens in the heartland in like the smaller states aren't really reported all that heavily unless it's like a massacre or a true national horror, you know? But I don't know.
Yeah.
It's kind of heavy. I don't know. Crazy stuff. When it gets in the news, while I just contemplate the horrors of being an American.
Let's get to the news. Start spreading the news. And I'll say to myself, the news, the news. Be-bop-a-doo-va.
Goulet.
Goulet.
Goulet. You don't even blink, do you? When you hear that song, New York, New York, what do you think of immediately?
I think
start spreading the news.
Frank Sinatra.
I'm here in today. The wrong answer. That's the wrong answer.
Sammy Davis Jr. The
wrong answer.
Dean Martin.
Wrong answer.
Okay.
The right.
What do you want me?
The
to
right
think?
Answer. Don't. I want you to remember. I want you to think of the smart gremlin from Gremlins 2 at the end. Where he sings it into the whole group of gremlins where they're about to break out of that giant conglomerate building, but they let the light in and kill them all. And they all die in horrible non-CG
practical effect deaths.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense then.
Yeah, because the kid moves from Clampett. I think Clampett is the name of the company, but he moves from his little town to New York because that's where the job went. He was going to be like an interior decorator or something like that. Watch Gremlins 2. It's amazing. Love that damn movie. Speaking of movies, we're not going to talk about those now. We're going to talk about video games. Psych! Got you.
Maybe I'm one who has no video game news. Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of corniness, I guess PlayStation's going to do another State of Play. Remember how successful that first one was?
Introducing, ladies and gentlemen, the president of PlayStation.
He's just a robot comes out. It's just Vince McMahon gorilla walks out.
Awkward.
Welcome
to Kingdom Hearts 4.
Welcome to Final Fantasy VII. Now on the PlayStation. You know, they used to have fake presidents and stuff back in the day, like promotional presidents.
Yeah.
You know, they need to just bring that back, but literally have just a dude dressed like Iron Man with like PlayStation colors, and that's the president of PlayStation. You know, like almost like Cletus the football, the robotic football player on Fox. Cletus the Did you know that's the name of the robot? Is Cletus? That's stupid.
Did not know.
Right? Anywho, PlayStation is doing another State of Play, which is pretty much a ripoff of the Nintendo Direct, where they're going to be going over.
But it's called State of Play. It's not PlayStation Direct. So I don't know what you're talking.
Winner. When? It's called State of Play, but it's a play on the state of Nintendo Directs.
Yeah. Wait, no, but there's nothing direct about it. It doesn't say direct in the title.
But it's stated, hence the word state.
Okay. That's all I got.
That's all I got. Sorry. This is dumb. They're going to be remastering, remaking Medieval. I don't know which yet. I'm hoping it's a full-blown remake. like they did a Spyro, battle royale. But yeah, medieval battle. Don't say that because there's a high chance that it'll be something that dumb and ruined. I'm already worried about Borderlands 3.
In the remake, medieval battle royale. Back to the school.
Battle again. Royale. Oh. Can you imagine if they finally make a sequel to Bully Rockstar does? And it's just a battle royale game where you're like in a you're at recess and all the kids have to like fight each other.
Yes.
I just gave them an idea. Shit.
Careful.
That one's on me, guys. I'm sorry. So apparently they're going to be showing off some new IPs at the State of Play. Don't get excited. Please don't get excited. Because they're not going to show you anything you want to see, man. You know, they're not announcing anything until the PS5 is ready to go. So are you going to get like Iron Man VR again? Maybe everyone's going to be bummed out and the crowd goes mild. Oh, man. Speaking of mild news, I'll let you talk about this one, Winter. This one probably is going to hit a little closer to home.
So Epic Games, you know, the creators of Fortnite and Fortnite have brought to you or have now acquired the Psyonix developer. Psyonix. And Psyonix has created Rocket League, as many of you know. Rocket League is probably their most well-known game, as far as I can tell.
That's it. That's all they got.
Yes.
Yeah.
So there is a love-hate relationship with this. Mostly hate, because it's the internet. I've already heard by one person that he's afraid that they're going to turn into a free-to-play. Like, not even afraid, but he's like, yeah, they're going to turn into a free-to-play. And then I don't know if that's supposed to be a bad thing or a good thing. I think it would be a good thing because that means more scrubs.
More players, you know? More players is always a good thing.
Yeah.
But then again, like you said, more scrubs.
Now, so I don't know how this positive changes where a lot of people are saying the competitive side of Rocket League can get a bump. When, first of all, Rocket League was already making its way into the television world, getting some televised esports. So I don't know what they mean by Epic Games really helping the competitive, the pro scene.
Pro circuit. Yeah. Well, I mean, more players and more visibility to the game is only going to increase it's the money it brings, right?
Yeah. That's
a good thing.
Yeah. But this is a major acquisition, I would say. It raises some eyebrows, meaning, so if Rocket League becomes free to play, what happens to the people that have already spent money on it?
That's always the thing, isn't it? But that's with anything. Like PlayStation Plus puts out free games every month, but there was that one guy who paid $60 on it. You know what I mean?
Yep. But that was years ago. What do you do with those people?
How old is Rocket League at this point?
Oh, well played.
You know what I'm saying? Rocket League's going to make its money in skins and all the crazy stuff you can buy a la carte in that game, right? So Rocket League's always going to be that money, like that live service, as some people would say. So I don't think it's going to be hurting for money. And making it free to play will have a lot of early adapters. And then the people who want to be a whale and spend 5 G's on skins and tire treads and smoke screens and whatever, they're going to spend that money. And all the OGs can have all the, one, have the experience, because they're going to be way better than these new adapters, and maybe lock away some of the skins that only the OGs could have access to, you know, or re-release them later. Do it like Overwatch style.
Yeah.
You know? Like, I always wish that Overwatch was free to play. It would be a way easier entry level for Overwatch to be free to play, because you spend so much in all the extra stuff for Overwatch. That's another game I'm just waiting out. Like, it doesn't matter to me. I've already bought it. But, you know, a lot of people would probably want to play it more. Like, Overwatch on the Switch would be a big get.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I think that would be huge for the Switch if they can get Overwatch, which I'm surprised they haven't done yet. You know what I mean? And have it be crossplay? That'd be insane, dude. You know? But yeah, are you one of those where it's like, ew, boo, Epic Games?
No.
Or does it really matter to you?
Ridiculous. It doesn't matter to me. It's hard for me to get that upset about a company that is releasing good content, regardless of what people think of it.
Right. I mean,
you might have an argument of what they're taking your data, I guess. There's arguments of Epic Games doing that, but I already have the suspicion that my data is already out there, as should everyone else.
Don't put out nothing you don't want seen, man. Real talk. This reminds me a lot of when Disney bought Marvel, and everyone just freaked out because, like, this is going to be the end of Marvel. They're gonna dull it down, and Marvel's going to get ruined by Disney because Disney doesn't know how to XYZ. And Infinity War just made $2 billion in, like, 10 days or something stupid. You know what I mean? Just because the conglomerate buys your thing, it only means good things for your thing unless you're EA. Unless anyone but EA, you know, you'll have to worry about it. So I personally think Epic acquiring Rocket League, which is, you know, that's their game, but maybe this will open the door for them to make new IPs with a bit more money behind them, and you know what I mean. So I think it's a good thing. Speaking of the opposite side of good vibes in gaming, apparently there's going to be a protest, if it's already happened. By employees of Riot Games are just going to walk out on the whole gaming company because of, like, bad practices and just bad gaming atmosphere. And the reason I bring this up, because I don't really like talking about overly negative things on the podcast, but I did want to kind of talk about the game developer culture,
yes,
and how it's becoming more and more toxic, or these practices are becoming more and more visible to the overall, like, non-informed masses. You know, it's like everyone's being worried about crunch time, and everyone's worried about losing their jobs, and they're firing people left and right. And it's like, I hate to say it, but is it time for gaming to get a union? You think?
That means farting on your SOTS and farting on Riot Games. Okay, this is the winter. Here's coming straight off of the trash bin, folks. Is it time for a union? I don't know. I don't work for the company. It's up for the if the employees are able to unionize and the company's for it, then I guess it is time. But if it doesn't, then it doesn't. There's no one forcing them to work for Riot Games. They can go somewhere else. And I think they should, if they're going to the point of the sexual harassment of the two employees in question were so severe, then I would say, and their company obviously has a you cannot sue them clause.
Yeah.
By the way, why would you ever sign that for a business?
Sign that.
Particularly, again, it's Riot Games. It's not like you're talking about PlayStation or Xbox sort of thing. You're talking about Riot Games, folks. It's League of Legends.
Yeah. And it's nutty, man. It's so nutty. And you're right. And there's some things I can test where it's like, some people don't feel like they can go anywhere else. Some people are like, this is my big break in gaming. I'm working for the guys who make League of Legends. It's horrible. And I work 100-hour work weeks, and I'm being sexually harassed, but I'm here. You know, right. I'm doing. Some people have that mentality, and some people can't break from that. And they're rationalizing their own little personal hell for some slice of career heaven that they think they're getting. But like you said, at the end of the day, it's Riot Games.
Yes.
You know?
Like, and I'm telling you right now, if you think that to unionize is going to solve your problems, it might solve some of them, but you're going to have a ton more problems because I just hear horror stories from folks of being in unions where it's good sometimes, but then it can be very bad very quickly. You need to be careful of the gaming community, and I would say even like content creators in general, need to be careful of going, being a, we need to do 100% of this or 100% of that. I'm always going to be an advocate for having options on the table, where if you want to be a company that does not allow unions, then so be it. But if you want to be a company that has unions, be it.
But there has to be checks and balances to this thing, though.
Maybe.
You know, because it's illegal to work anyone past 80 hours in this country. Am I in the state? Am I wrong? Like,
yeah, I would be against that law too, but that would be that's a little bit of crazy winter coming out.
Yeah, man. I'm just saying, like, realistically, like, it's the culture where it's like, you're not forced to work 100 hours. You can work your 80 hours every 2 weeks.
Yeah.
But everybody else is doing it, and we're bringing in new hires every day. So, you know, if you don't want to do it, I understand. But just know that everybody else is doing it. And then you're like, what? Like, so I have to do it. We're not saying that. We're just letting you know that we're bringing in new people on Monday.
Yeah, we call that peer pressure. I thought we had a PSA on that in high school.
I'm just saying, that's the atmosphere, man. It's literally the worst. And all these companies, even like NetherRealm has been busted on this stuff. A Rockstar. I mean, it's a systemic issue in the gaming community.
And how do you address that? Or would you say it is an integral part of the gaming industry?
Look, man, I do you want, it's like blood diamonds, man. Are you okay with that? Are you okay knowing that some guy wrecked his 20s to make, you know, Red Dead Redemption 2 as long as you're having a good time with it?
Well, I never have a good time. That's the problem.
That's my secret cap. Yeah. I never have fun.
Right. Like, it definitely sucks. And I would definitely, like, if it comes down to being clear, like, this company supports unions, this company doesn't, I'd probably lean towards companies that have unions more than I would companies that do not have unions.
Yeah, but I mean,
to say that it needs to be either or to remove the conversation of folks going, do I want to live? It's like removing the conversation of folks want, like, you're too smart, you're too dumb to not sign this contract with the devil. You'll be peer pressured into it.
Yeah.
Like, some people, they're able to thrive in that for an hour or like a year, and then that's their entryway. Others do not.
But that's the majority of people, I think. I hate to use majority to minorities, but you know what I'm saying? Like, it's people are going to go into peer pressure, man. So not everyone has that iron will to be like, yeah, this is dumb, I'm leaving. Forget that. I don't think that's the majority of people, you know. But who knows, man? I don't know. You throw words around like unions and like unhealthy workspaces and stuff like that. And like you said, is it integral to the game making industry to work those long hours and to break your back over a game that may be on the tip of people's tongues for what, 2-3 months, and then it's $40 at GameStop? Is it worth it? You know, I don't know. It's really up to the person. It goes back to our WWE football thing. Exactly. Is it worth wrecking your body and possibly giving yourself an uncomfortable life forever for that moment in the sun? Some people it's worth it. You know, some people it isn't. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think, like you said, there should be options to it. But sadly, this world is very black and white. You know what I mean? It's very all or nothing, especially in the business world. You know what I mean? It's like, you're stupid if you don't sign this, but you're going to be miserable for the next 5-10 years of your life. But you'll have money, though, and you'll have security. But you'll never see your family. You're going to be working 100-hour work weeks, and you're going to be stressed out for the majority of this time frame. But you'll be working at EA. You know, isn't that lovely? Mm-hmm. Let's move on from this. It's a good conversation, I think.
Yeah.
It's a very good conversation that could be elaborated on. And the last, and you know, I wanted to start motoring here. So the last bit of, unless you just want to talk about this next thing, I don't really
know. No, we can switch to the Switch.
Let's switch to the Switch. So this is the weirdest thing in the world. So recently, Capcom's own Devil May Cry 1, the very first Devil May Cry, is being ported to the Switch. Not the collection, not the HD collection that has 1, 2, 3, 4. Just one. Just Devil May Cry 1 is coming to the Switch. And it's causing murmurs to say that Dante may be one of the newest downloadable characters in Smash, which I think would be awesome. Even though I wouldn't want it to be Dante. I would prefer if it was Nero. I think Nero would be a way cooler addition to Smash than Dante.
No, we're going to have Dante.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. That's just what I was going to say. Yeah. Is that that's the consensus. Dante is Devil May Cry. Smash Brothers is all about like the hero character. We're not going to have Raiden in Smash. We're going to have Solid Snake. You know what I mean? We're going to have the character. We're not going to have Blanca in Smash. We're going to have Ryu. You know what I mean? So I think just the same thought process of, no, we're not going to have Virgil, even though that would be awesome, have Virgil in Smash. We're going to have Dante from Devil May Cry, the face of Devil May Cry. And there's always this weird thing where it's like the only qualification of being in a Smash game is if your series has been on a Nintendo system at least once. Not your character, but your series. That's how they got Joker from Persona in there, because apparently there was some Persona spinoff that was like on the GameCube like a decade ago or something. So as long as your character has been on the Nintendo platform within its lifetime, then your character has a shot of being in Smash. And Devil May Cry has always been like a Sony thing. And then it became a Sony and Microsoft thing during the 360, I think, with Devil May Cry 4. But now they're just putting this on there just to put it on there, it seems. From what I read, I don't even think it's a remaster. It's just they're just putting the game on there, like, as is. It's super weird.
Devil May Cry, I know, 40 FPS?
Dang. Devil May Cry 40-bit. It's just gonna look like Rayman, the original Rayman. You want to fly through this movie news real quick? So I don't want to make this podcast
too long for dead. You guys. Sonic design, wow. Old movies dead.
Wow. That's the most... Stop being disrespectful to Peter Mayhew, dude.
I'm sorry.
He was a sweet man. He had piercing blue eyes, and he was Chewbacca the Wookiee, dude. Yeah. What a Wookiee! Chewie, is that you? Oh, Chewie. You know the Chewbacca song?
No.
Well, that's going to be the end of this podcast. Just so you guys know, I'm going to put the Chewbacca song at the end of the podcast episode. Yes. You are everything nasty. Don't get me started on the Swamp Thing theme song. It's still the best. Shut up. Peter Mayhew, may he be remembered. He passed away at 74, which is a pretty good average lifespan for a male, I guess. He played Chewbacca the Wookiee. That was his claim to fame. Apparently, he was the salt of the earth. Great guy. He will be missed, and the internet is mourning him as we speak. So,
yeah.
I want to talk about. I'm gonna pick two more things to talk about. We have to talk about the Sonic the Hedgehog design thing, man. We have to talk about it. Because it's the craziest thing in the world.
It's wiggity 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 whack.
It's wiggity whack. So last week we talked about the trailer, and we all had our weird feelings about the trailer and how Jim Carrey's going to carry that movie.
Uh-huh.
But what's the craziest thing is that the internet exploded with memes and jokes, and it interneted, right? It's gonna do that no matter what. But the strangest part about it is that the actual filmmakers have come out and said, you know what, guys, we heard you. We're going to work to do a complete redesign of the character in the 0 hour to fix it. We're going to fix it. And then they did hashtag fix it fast. Like, I almost feel bad that we live in a world that social media has so much power that it's adjusting the direction of people's visions. Right. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that, well, they were like, so scared of negative backlash, no worries, that they're just going to totally redesign a character that they've spent months getting right. You know what I mean? Like, that's nuts to me. Yeah. Like, are they that afraid? Like, and they don't understand that the same fanboys who are complaining about it are the same people who are going to be there the first day to see it.
Right.
You know, you're going to get their money anyway. So why give into that pressure?
I think the pressure giving is more, it's like, I'm predicting that they're trying to make this into a franchise. So they're wanting to, so it's like, now is the time to get it right. And then, right. Yeah. And yeah. I think it's interesting too, that we live in a day and age that they can quickly change something like that. Like, boom. Like, we don't have to spend hours upon, or like, we now have to spend months on fixing the character. It could happen in a few weeks.
But is that good work, though? Like, no, can you imagine them?
Good work. Well, I don't know. I haven't seen the new look.
No one's seen it yet. They're apparently working on it. But it's like, can you imagine if, like, Lord of the Rings came out and we saw our first shot of Gollum and the internet just clowned the mess out of them? They're like, well, you know, we spent like 4 years getting this Gollum right, but we're going to switch this around just because you guys are thinking it's not a good design. Can you imagine what kind of nightmare that would be? you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
Like, can you imagine? That's insane to me, man. Just stick with your guns. If this is your weird vision of Sonic, then let it rock, dude. Don't give in to internet peer pressures. That's kind of the worst. You know, because they're the loud minority. They're not the majority of people who are just like, all right, fine, I guess. I'm not even defending the design. It's a horrible design. My problem is that they let the peer pressures of social media get to them to the point where they're going to make a multi-million dollar business decision to redesign a character when the movie is at the stage where they're showing trailers. Then that means the movie's just about done. You know what I mean? Principal filming is probably all done. They're doing post-production stuff. And now they have to go into reshoots and redesigns because, oh no, the internet got jokes. You know, that's bad business to me, man. Stick with your guns, guys. Don't.
It's bad for the business.
Bad for the business. Just real quick, a sequel to The Collector's coming out. Yes, I love that series.
I love it too.
Yeah, The Collector's badass, dude. Yeah. If you've never seen,
where he puts them in like crates, right?
Or yeah, it's like that crazy killer with that mask where his eyes are like silver.
Second one, like the guy from the first one finds the house.
Yeah,
and somehow the guy screeches at him.
He hisses at him or something. Like, what the hell?
Right? Yeah, I'm like, wait a minute.
Dude. He makes like a monster noise. He just goes, and the guy's like, what? And then he like stabs him with a real shiny blade. And I thought this series was done, dude. I was like, oh man, I guess it ended fine. The Collector and The Collection are some of the best modern horror films. In my opinion, they're great. Mm-hmm. And to hear that they're following this up with, what would they call the sequel? The Collected?
Let's see here.
The Collected?
The Collector, The Collection. Let's go The Collection's Auctioneer. Already done.
The Auctioneer, though. I like it. I like it.
And 35,
40, 35, 40, 40, 44, 45, 45, 45, 45, 50. No, call it In the Movie Zone. And in The Collector won, yes, yet again. He won, what was that show on A&E? Storage Wars.
Storage War. Money own this town. That's Pawn Stars, dang it.
You imagine if The Collector's about to kill, he just goes, yep.
Yep.
Oh no, The Collector's coming. Yes. Oh man. But yeah, I had to talk about that. That's super good news. Also, real quick, Hellraiser is getting a reboot, which we have to talk about
because the show was like. I always say when we talk about Hellraiser,
what?
Hellraiser!
That stupid song that I hate so much.
Too fast enough, dang it.
I would allow it. I had to cut that one off at the pass. My only problem with this is that it's being developed by stupid David S. Goyer, dude. I don't like that at all, man. I do not like
that Goyam. The Goy?
No, man, he's kind of a creep, dude. I don't like him. He has some very gnarly things to say about Marvel when he was writing like Batman v Superman or something. He's a kind of a creep, so I'm not a fan of David S. Goyer.
Isn't the owner of the company making Borderlands 3 a creep as well?
Yeah, Randy Pitchford is a huge creep. He's a mega creep. But
he ain't no Hellraiser.
It's Borderlands 3, though. It's so bad. I hate it.
Man.
It's such a rock and a hard place, dude. It's really separating
it's like
the
it's such art. A blood and a diamond.
Yeah, man. It's a bloody game diamond, dude. Do you support this game knowing
sometimes
that it's feeding?
We don't get the game we want, but we get the game we deserve.
It's like, yeah. do I support this man to put food in his mouth knowing he's a horrible human being, but he's making a product that I really want?
While you're having this philosophy debate, you already have 3 copies of the game.
Yeah, I've already bought it 6 times. You know, it's the same thing with Fallout 76. I was so close to buying that game until I heard it was a trash fire. I almost just pre-ordered it because it's Fallout. But it's like, I have to separate the art from the artist, man. You know what I'm saying? That being said, David S. Goyer did write Blade, and I will never take that away from him. I just don't think he's Hellraiser material. And if I got to see if Clive Barker gave him his blessing. If Clive Barker gave the man his blessing, and he read the script, and he's like, this is going to be amazing, then I'll be cool with it. But if Clive is not even, like, talking about it, then I'm like, nah, I'm straight, dude. I'm super straight.
Yeah, Hellraiser is interesting because you have to do it just right. Like, I'm afraid they're going to try to do jump scares because, it's 2019.
Yeah. I'm super afraid because Hellraiser, at its core, is like a love story. It's not a horror movie, you know?
It's an erotic horror movie.
It's an erotic, yeah, right? And if you don't play it that way, or at least have the inklings of the original source material, or even maybe, this is crazy, but base it off the Hellbound Heart, the original book by Clive Barker, maybe have a crazy idea like that. It may be good, but I don't see David S. Goyer doing that. He's a bit of a hack, dude. So I'm just like, I don't know. I'm not hype.
But he'll be raising hell.
He is going to be raising hell. And he will have such sights to show you. I bet you heard that at least 84 times at this point.
Hold on. One second. Stupid commercial. Damn it. Wrong time for a commercial.
No, we're moving on. Lastly, the new Spider-Man Far From Home trailer dropped.
Damn it. Okay.
See, you have failed the city. So now we have to talk about Spider-Man before we close up the podcast.
No!
you got to do the Darth Vader one. No!
No! No! Jared Leto! Wait, no. Jake Gyllenhaal.
Jake Gyllenhaal. No. We're all just all over the place. So there's stuff about this trailer I want to talk about real quick. Have you seen the trailer?
Saw the first one.
Okay, did you see Infinity War? Did you see Endgame?
Not yet. No spoilers! Okay.
Then I really can't talk about this trailer because I don't want to spoil you. But you do know Mysterio's in his film, right?
Yes.
It has nothing to do with Endgame. Mysterio is my personal favorite Spider-Man villain. My favorite over Green Goblin and Doc Ock and Venom. I love Mysterio because his whole thing, his whole shtick is wasting Spider-Man's time. All he wants to do is waste Spider-Man's time. Like he does like bank heist and stuff, but for the most part, he's just there to just bother Spider-Man and do stupid stuff like make illusions and shit. He's the worst. He's the best. So seeing my boy on the big screen does warm thine heart. But the implications of the trailer, I'm not going to spoil anything, are all for naught because I know that Mysterio as a character is full of it. You know what I mean? Mysterio as a character doesn't tell the truth at all. He's a big, his whole shtick is he's a liar. You know what I mean? So it makes me feel a certain way about the trailer. Because the trailer has some big implications to the future of the Marvel Universe. But it's coming from Mysterio. His whole thing is illusions and tricks.
Does Wolverine appear at all in the commercial?
Not yet. I did hear a snicked, though. So it just could be Mysterio trolling. I did hear a snicked, but that could have been me, dude.
Yes.
So I don't know. But the Spider-Man trailer's out. It's very spoiler heavy. So if you've never seen if you haven't seen Endgame yet, and there's even a disclaimer by Tom Holland at the beginning of the trailer, like, look, this is very Endgame spoilery. So just letting you know, if you haven't seen Endgame, you probably should turn this off and watch that first.
Turn it off! Turn it off!
Turn off the lights. Go watch Endgame.
Go watch it!
Just stop the podcast and run out the house. But yeah, it looks interesting. I'm sold because it's Mysterio. I love all things Mysterio. He's the coolest. So
like Rey Mysterio?
I do like Rey Mysterio as well. Rey Mysterio, where it's like...
He killed a guy.
He legit killed a guy. That's not funny, man.
It's not. I'm being serious. He killed somebody in the ring.
I know, man. It's just, why'd you just say it like that, though? You're killing me, dude. I don't know what you're talking about. You know, like Halle Berry ran the dude over once.
So did
Matthew Broderick.
Caitlin did as well.
Yeah, Sophia.
The Jenner.
Yeah, man. Matthew Broderick killed a guy.
What? I wasn't laughing. You're the one laughing.
Yeah, just because you said it so dry, so deadpan out of nowhere, it threw me off. Wasn't ready for that.
No, it wasn't out of nowhere. You said Mysterio, so you should have known full well that I was going to bring up.
And I'm cool with you bringing up Rey Mysterio. I like Rey Mysterio.
Sorry, Rey Mysterio Jr.
Jr. He does a 619. He reps Southern California. He's a generously good guy. And he wears like superhero themed costumes. But
by the way, I forgot to mention something.
Okay.
In the news.
Okay. Okay.
They announced three dates for the new start for the upcoming Star Wars movies.
I did not want to talk about that. I'm so salty about that. I'm so mad.
Well, we don't need to talk about the dates. I just thought it was a great idea to go like 1 year it's going to be Star Wars, next year it's going to be Avatar, next year it's going to be Star Wars, next year it's going to be Avatar, and back and forth until we all die.
Until we all die forever. The war begins now.
Rey Mysterio.
You know, Rey Mysterio killed Avatar.
Yeah. Booyaka, booyaka. 619, yo.
619, yo. And then he does the big giant jump with the smoke.
Oh, I scrolled down too far. Endgame running. Spoilers. Okay.
Oh, no. Did you know that Thanos killed a guy?
You're trying to make a joke out of it. I'm just trying to keep our audience informed about Rey Mysterio killing someone in the ring.
How many deaths do you think have happened legit in the ring?
That happened in the ring?
In the ring.
There's
two I can think of.
Owen Hart?
Yeah, that's the big one. Which is not funny. That was horrible. That was a horrible botch. Right.
And then
that sucked.
There's got to be a couple.
It's got to be a couple, right? I mean, there's been like tons of botched landings where it's ruined people's careers and stuff, but like legit people passing away in the ring.
Okay, Google.
Wow. We're doing it.
I actually have that shut off on my phone.
Smart man.
So what are you looking forward to this weekend?
Yeah, man. I'm looking forward to having a least dark podcast next week.
Yeah. I'm just a little light in my room, so I'm feeling a little edgy.
Are you afraid of the dark cast?
I'm going to listen to some Morrissey. Spent the day in bed.
I'm gonna listen to some Tool, man. Listen to some old school.
What haven't done to you? Do unto others.
Jeez, what am I looking forward to, man? I don't know. Detective Pikachu is coming out, I think, soon. I want to see that. That looks like dumb fun.
Yeah,
but I don't want to be the only grown man in that theater, so I have to figure that out. It's not a good look.
You will be.
You gotta do like Yoda. You will be. Straight up. So I have to figure that out. I may have to like bootleg that or something. I can't be that guy. Looking forward to that. I guess looking forward to trying Rocket League again, even though I was embarrassed on Rocket League and I had to run away.
Folks, we only played once together, and then he said that he needs to train.
I needed to train, and I can't. And the only way you train is with other humans who are expecting things of you, and I can't. It's horrible. It's a horrible experience. But I want to get back on my Switch. I want to play some more Rocket League. Looking forward to doing some artwork for the podcast. Definitely looking forward to, I want to do some more interest, some new things with the show. I don't know. Maybe some new segments. One that I've been working on for quite some time that I've mentioned in the past that I want to roll out soon. It's just not ready yet. It needs to be ready. So not a lot this week. Just, you know, may go see a movie, do some art, light artwork when the mood strikes, you know. Typical Mike G stuff. What are you looking forward to, man?
I'm looking forward to... I'm restringing my 12-string guitar, so that's fun. I have this thing coming in the mail that's supposed to be a hat stretcher, which is, I have a hat that's a little too small for me, and if I put this thing on, it's supposed to make it bigger. Sharks game 7 tomorrow.
Go Sharks.
Yeah. The Sharks are the reason why my schedule's all over the place.
I hate the Sharks. I'm more of a Rangers fan. Rangers.
You are Rangers? Well, why did you pick them?
Because my dad's from New York. Oh. That's as far as I've thought it through. I'm not a hockey fan. Well,
Kevin Smith is a Rangers fan.
And I hate Kevin
Smith. What was that?
I don't hate Kevin Smith. I just say I can't. Yeah. Kevin Smith's fine. Ignore that. He's fine.
Yeah.
But you no, need to stop yelling, I picked the Rangers. About
plane seats.
It's not, man. As a big man, I feel his pain, dude.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. No. I sucked it up. Anyway.
Yeah, man. Like I sucked it up. I figured it out. No, when it comes to hockey, I know two teams. That's the Anaheim Ducks because of the Mighty Ducks, the movie, and the New York Rangers only because and the Kings because the Kings had a cool jersey. In the New York Rangers, only because my father is from New York, and I get to say Rangers. Yeah. That's the only reason I like it.
That's all. So that's all I got really for this coming week. And also, 17 pro wrestlers have died in the ring, according to Wikipedia. What do you have? What do you have going on, Mike G?
You just keep bringing this podcast down. I can't. That's rough, dude. 17.
Yeah. Oh.
May a flight of angels sing thee to thy rest. That's it. Do you have any other closing thoughts? Any before we close this bad boy out, man?
Yeah. Yeah, check me out on social media. I'm at Trashmonk the Third, Trashmonk III. I have a funeral I'm going to on Saturday, a memorial of life.
And, sorry to hear that, man.
Yeah, yeah. It's all right. It was a ripe age for this old man.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I remember playing. He would play drums. I would play a little bit of guitar, and yeah. So that's gonna be a somber but good time reflecting on things. So yeah. That's all I got.
Yeah. Also, you can also find fun, energetic, life-filled remembrances of old and bad horror movies, and good regular movies like Guyver Dark Hero. After this podcast, go watch Guyver Dark Hero. You'll thank me later. At MNerdiverse, that is our Twitter handle, at MNerdiverse. Go follow that channel, and you'll be up to date with all Master of the Nerdiverse thoughts, episodes, polls, GIFs, memes, all the stuff that we gather from the spirit of the internet lands there. And if you're listening to the show on any of the podcast avenues that we're available on, leave us a ranking, leave us a rating, leave us a review, because Google Analytics highly ranks websites and pieces of media that have high rankings or even have ratings in general. So the more the merrier. Let us know how we're doing. And that would definitely help benefit the channel, because we want this channel to grow like Audrey 2 from Little Shop of Horrors.
Feed me. Feed me.
You can do it. I'm a mean green mother from outer space, and I'm a bad cat.
Mean green bad.
Sorry.
I don't know the looks. I've
met them. Watch Little Shop of Horrors. I've been naming a lot of movies to watch.
With a BB gun.
Good.
You'll be a dentist.
I'll be a dentist. Okay, enough singing. I've, of course. Okay. You're going to make me, damn, I have to watch that tonight. I've been, of course, your host, Mike G.
And I've been your host with the mostest, Trash Monk
III. Yeah. And we will always ask you to go one step beyond. I'll be your dentist.